In this tutorial, we learn the staff lines, how notes are being named, the treble clef, the bass clef, and the C alto viola or tenor clef. But first of all, I'm not a native English speaker, so sometimes you may have to be creative in trying to understand what I mean. First of all, let's have a look at the staff lines. We have five of them. In these staff lines, tones or notes are written. We deal with tones because notes have a pitch and a durance, and what we do here is only the pitch, so it's more like tones than notes. I mix these words, but you know what I mean, I think. Clefs. There are different kinds of clefs. Why? A good question. But if you bring a keyboard to your mind, you see, this keyboard here has 33 keys, but a standard keyboard piano has 88 keys. And how many notes or tones do we get in a staff into five staff lines? Let's have a look at this. We have a rule, and it's always one note is on the line, the next one is in the gap between the lines, and we start under the first line and end above the fifth line. And now we number this, and you see 11 notes out of 88 in five staff lines. Look like we have to come up with something. The solution is we introduce signs telling us how to interpret the tones and notes on and between the staff lines. These signs are called clefs. They look like this. The solution is we introduce signs telling us how to interpret the tones and notes on and between the staff lines. These signs are called clefs. They look like this. So this clef, the treble or G clef, because the point, this point on the clef indicates that the tone G should stand on here on this staff line, so that's why it's called G clef. But it's not commonly used. We use the name treble clef. So as we can see, we name tones with letters, but don't worry, we basically only need seven letters, not all of the alphabet. A, B, C, D, E, F, G. After the G, A comes again. That means if you have eight tones, and after the G, the eighth note would call A again. To distinguish the different notes with equal names, we use things like capital letters, small letters, or numbers to make a real clear difference. We will take a look at this later. The treble clef. Let's look at the letters and notes first. We have A, B, C, D, E, F, G. It's a logical system, as you can see. Already we know where the tone G is. It's here, because it's defined through the clef where it has to be. So now we want to see how where the other notes are, and the rule was always on the line, between the line, and then back on the line. We do this in the beginning upwards or higher. As you can see, it's always on the line between, on the line between, on the line between, on the line between. So, and you can see the alphabet from the A and the G, and you can see it starts with G, ends with G. And now we do this downwards. Same principle. And again here the alphabet. Basically we are writing notes in lowercase letters. So what we do is bring them in, and now we can see we have small or lowercase letters. But as you can see, we have several equal letters now, but as well you can clearly see that these notes have different pitches. The G on the right side is higher than the G on the left side or in the middle. So how can we clearly identify these notes with letters? Pretty easy, we introduce numbers next to the letters. As you can see, the numbers change from 1 to 2 at the tone C. The tone C thus seems to be the reverence tone for the change of numbering. The distance from one letter to its nearest possible occurrence is called octave. Let's have a look at this D. From D to the next possible D, this is called an octave. Now we have to find out how tones could be written above the stuff or below the stuff, such as C1 or A2, because you see on the left C1 is missing and on the right A2 is missing. So let's have a look at this. The easiest way would be just to put it a little below the D1, like this. But then it couldn't be distinguished clearly from the D1, meaning 50% of the musicians would may play a C, and the other 50% may play a D, or some play a B. So it's not a really good way to do this like this. But the solution is easy. We introduce a ledger line that clearly indicates that the note is on a line. So, like this. Now, 100% of the musicians would play a C here. The same we could do with the A2 above the staff. Now, clearly identifiable. This way, notes could be written even if they are outside the staff lines. Same principle, like always, each note has to be perfectly identifiable. A note must be either on a ledger line or above, between it. take a look at the B2. It's above the first ledger line. The A2 was on the first ledger line, and the B2 is above it. C3 then must be on the second line. A2 was on the first. C3 has to be on the second. And again, you see here at C, the number changes from 2 to 3. D3, of course, should be here. If we go below the C1, we have the B under the first ledger line, the A on the second, and of course the G below the second. It's a logical principle, and as you can see. Here we have no numbers in this octave, which is logical as well, because we have from C1 and then C2, C3, so if we go below C1, there shouldn't be any numbers. Though this way, pretty much tones could be written in this stuff and ledger lines. About 20 origin notes, originating notes. That means all the notes without accidentals, which are the white keys on the keyboard. But using too many ledger lines start to make things a bit confusing. So for very high or low instruments, we need different clef signs, obviously. The higher instruments, they use the treble clef and indicate by writing an 8 above the clef that all the notes that are written in this octave should be played one octave higher. So for the high registers, we don't have extra new clefs, and it's not needed because too high music that's too high played is not so very often. But for the low instruments, we need it because, like trombone, bass, we have to find a solution. First, take a look at the lower instrument. At best is the electric bass, the four-string bass, and its lowest tone would look like this in the treble clef. As you can see, we have 7 ledger lines. That's very confusing if we have melodies written into these ledger lines, and it's, you know, that's very, very hard to read. So we have to find a way to change this. So if we have a deeper look, to make it a bit clearer, we extend all the ledger lines and make a staff with 12 lines. So then we insert all the notes up to the treble clef notes we already know. And as we know, here the C1 is. I make this line green to see that this is the first ledger line underneath the upper stuff, the normal stuff. So this is a C1, meaning that the next note has to be the D1. Let's name the other tones. Again, the logical system is here. The alphabet, you know, if you take a look, A, B, C, D, you know, find the A's and you will see the alphabet. So it's very logical and easy to understand, I think. But what problem is that we have here, these names are here twice, so this is not allowed, because if you tell the pianist play a low E, for instance, he could say, which one do you want? Is it my, could I do this or what? So we couldn't do this, so we need to make it very clear here. We change these as follows, and this is very easy. We change them to capital letters. So now we have capital letters and small letters, and then we have letters, numbers 1 to 2, whatever. So it's very clearly now. We have a unique name for each note, for each tone. Now you can see we have 5 lines in the upper stuff, then we have this ledger line, the green line, and then we have 6 lines. So we already know that this seems to be a very logical system, so maybe the bottommost line is as well a ledger line. Well, let's make one out of it and look what happens. So, looks good. And we take the green line out and change it to what it is, a ledger line as well. And then things become clear. You see now we have two systems with 5 lines and ledger lines between it. If we now extend the lines to the left, we really can see these two systems. Now we just need a clef sign. Let the note don't tumble out of the left. That's what I learned in primary school. You know, there always has to be a clef on the left side. Since the treble clef is already taken, we need a different symbol. And we choose this one. And this is called the bass clef. Or the F clef. Because it determines the F. Yeah. If you see the green line, it shows where the F has to be. Let's clean up a bit. And now you can see the whole system and that those two systems belong together because they show you all the notes that are playable. Now it's possible for us to name each tone on the piano clearly. No questions what means. And for the piano player is one more thing, that all he plays with the left hand is written in the bass clef, and all that is written in the treble clef is played with the right hand. Right hand treble, left hand bass clef. But there's one more thing. Imagine you would play a viola, cello or trombone. Then you mainly would play in the following range. The problem here, whatever clef we choose, we always would have many ledger lines. If we would choose the treble clef, low tones, we have a lot of ledger lines. And if we were playing the bass clef and play high notes, we always have a lot of ledger lines. Trombone players often play only in the bass clef, and they have, you know, in a big band, the first trombone player, he has so many ledger lines, it's really, really hard to play, to read. The solution is very simple. We introduce a clef symbol that defines exactly the middle of the two staffs, the note C1. Here's the middle, and this clef defines the C1. But since on our staff systems only 5 staff lines are allowed, we must restore this state now. We do this the following way. Now you can see 5 lines. Looks a bit confusing. I clean it up a bit and you will see that's the way it is. Now we need a name, but the whole thing is very quite complicated, and the naming is as well. This clef has several names. I'll tell you more on that later. Here are the names. The C clef, because it defines the C, and the alto viola tenor clef. Okay, alto tenor, something different, but you will understand in a few minutes. Let's take a closer look at the naming. Something very special about this clef, because wherever you place it, you will define the C. And through this point, we already have seen this. This point defines the line where the C1 has to be. So basically, we could call it a C clef, since it defines the place of C1. So if you say this is a C clef, you're always right, because this is what it does. This is what it does. It just defines where the C has to be. And here are the common notes that we use. This, already seen, is the alto or viola clef. The C1 is on this line, and due to this, the other tones are in the logical system. But if you place it on this line, we won't call it an alto or viola clef, we would call it a tenor clef. And the C1, again, is defined by this line. Okay, now, tenor clef. Tenor is lower than alto, so why put it upwards, not downwards? Well, very easy. A tenor plays more notes in a lower case, so if we put it up the clef, then we have more low notes in the system, so it's logical. Well, quite complicated clef, but that's it. I hope everything is clear now, and you can use those clefs wherever you need it. Like the video if it helped you, and subscribe to my channel for more tutorials.